to our legacy.
Hi, I'm Beverly Zimet here in Las Vegas, Nevada, and I want to say thank you all for sharing your time with us this evening as we dedicate this day to National Vietnam Veterans Day. This is all about to our legacy, and we want to say thank you to all the Vietnam vets who served our country. Unfortunately, they left a legacy that's not always happy. They did not know the exposure to Agent Orange was going to create the mess that it did. So we are here now today to help the families and the generational things that are going on, open up that awareness and educate everyone that, hey, we have an issue here that needs to be rectified, and we want to be heard, and we want to reach out and help each and every one of you. That's what this project is all about, and we want to say thank you to Miriam Martinez for sharing her story and bringing this to life to help families with their struggles and know what to do, how to do it, and find the resources to get it done. So thank you again for spending that time with us this evening, and we have a show for you. So sit back, relax, and enjoy. I'd like to bring our host of the show on stage here, where she's gonna give you some absolutely morsels of greatness to work with your families. So Miriam Martinez, come on in.
Well, thank you so much, Beverly.
It's
awesome to be here.
It is, isn't it? We haven't done this in a long time.
I know, it's been a long time.
Exactly. You want to share with the audience exactly what To Our Legacy is and how it even got started?
Well, it got started, you know, many years ago when you are faced with a situation in life where it's critical. You know, you have to look at things in a different way. Our family decided to write a book called Agent Orange, Broken DNA, and it was about our journey the last few years, more than a few years, I guess you would say the last 40 years. And what we discovered on it, this journey, that our families are being affected by Agent Orange, a second generation, a third generation. They're now saying it's going into fourth generations. So today we are creating an awareness of to our Vietnam veterans and their families to let them know that they are not alone and we are here to support them.
Oh, thank you for sharing that. This is really something that is so necessary to get this information out and the understanding and that awareness, right?
Yeah.
So that's awesome. You talked a little bit about rare diseases. What exactly do you mean by rare diseases? Because I know the first time you said that to me, it's like, what's the difference between that rare disease than all the other stuff that they're telling, you know, that are going on out there in the health industry?
Well, rare diseases is abnormal defects that occur in veterans' families currently. With our family, I'm going to just name what it is. It's called hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia. HHT for a cure. I've worked with them for the last 10 years with our family. Our children have been diagnosed with that rare illnesses. It's a very rare disease. If you want to support rare diseases, you can always go to and see what Vietnam veterans have in that rare disease category. There's birthdefects.org. Okay. I'm getting too much.
Now, I know you mentioned, of course, the name of the book, Broken DNA.
Yes.
So obviously these rare diseases have something to do with broken DNA, but that's not the message we're getting across here today. We want you to really understand but it is about Agent Orange and where we can go now with the awareness of it. So Marion, talk a little bit about what these long-term effects are. Just, you know, roughly just kind of, you know, tell us what they can expect, you know, in just a few short words.
In a few short words, it's hard to say what you're going to expect, to be honest with you. I've been asked many times, you know, what are the steps? There aren't any. What are the symptoms? There aren't any. That's all I can tell you. But knowing that your veteran was in Vietnam and that exposure of the chemicals that they had out there, it wasn't just Agent Orange. There was multiple chemicals. It could be a combination of all of it.
Yeah, and who knows, right?
Right. You know, so I mean, it's a mixing pot.
Exactly. So what about the research? Is there any research or is it very minimal?
They do have research out there. Birthdefects.org has conducted an amazing research over the years. They started with the Agent Orange registry back in, I believe, the 70s or 80s, and then they seen there was abnormalities in their children, so they started that birthdefects.org.
Oh. .org. I know. We all go through like, what is that called?
I know. It's like,
yeah. You know, all of the information and these links and stuff are going to be attached to, you know, things later on tonight after the stream is done. So you'll be able to have all that information out there and the contact information. So don't worry about that right now. Yeah. Okay. So we are now going to take a short break.
Anxiety, depression, PTSD, ADHD, pain, inflammation, dealing with mental or physical health issues, or know someone who is? Relax, refresh, recover, revive. Natural health alternatives using hemp-derived CBD and other cannabinoids found in hemp are increasingly becoming more effective in managing various symptoms that affect your body, state of mind, and daily life. Planet Harvest Health's mission is to help those looking for natural, new, and better solutions for a healthier way of life. Specializing in small batch, handcrafted alternatives, providing higher quality and a cost-effective product. Go to planetharvesthealth.com for more information and education on how we can help you.
Oh, wow. I have the honor of introducing a long-standing legacy here in Las Vegas. A producer who actually is producing this show that you are about to see tonight. Stay tuned. His name is John Stiles, and he wants to share with you an interview that he did a while back. It's going to tear at your heartstrings. So sit back, relax, and grab a tissue. Thank you.
Okay, so one of the reasons I did ask you, I love talking about this passion of yours and the work that you do and everything, but one of the reasons that I did ask you to be a guest on my show is that I found out that you are a veteran.
Yes, I am.
You're a veteran of the Vietnam War.
Yes, that's true.
And I have interviewed several veterans over the course of my career, but Vietnam veterans are very reluctant to speak about their experiences. And I know that it is a difficult subject, and I applaud you and I thank you profoundly for saying that you would agree. Now, I never want to ask any questions that would make you uncomfortable.
Well, I don't have to answer them.
You don't have, well, and that's what I tell all my guests.
Yeah, right.
But I also don't want to touch upon anything, but I would love if you could just share a little bit about how you got into, you know, okay, the military, a little bit of your experience, and just talk, John.
Okay. But before we get into that,
okay,
I stumbled across this a little while ago, and I think it's important. I'd like to read this. And it's basically, it's to understand a military veteran, you must know. We left home as teenagers.
Would you like me to read it?
No, I can get through this. We left home as teenagers or in our early 20s for an unknown adventure. We loved our...
That's okay, John.
We loved our country enough to defend it and protect it with our own lives. We said goodbye to friends and family and everything we knew. We learned the basics, and then we scattered in the wind to the far corners of the earth. We found new friends and new family. We became brothers and sisters, regardless of our color, race, or creed. We had plenty of good times and plenty of bad times. We didn't get enough sleep. We smoked and drank too much. We picked up both good and bad habits. We worked hard and played harder. We didn't earn a great wage. We experienced the happiness of mail call and the sadness of missing important events. We didn't know when or even if we were ever going to see home again. We grew up fast, and yet somehow we never grew up at all. We fought for our freedom as well as our freedom of others. Some of us saw actual combat, and some of us didn't. Some of us saw the world, and some of us didn't. Some of us dealt with physical warfare. Most of us dealt with psychological warfare. We have seen and experienced and dealt with things that we can't fully describe or explain, as not all of our sacrifices were physical. We participated in time-honored ceremonies and rituals with each other, strengthening our bonds and camaraderie. We counted on each other to get our job done and sometimes to survive it at all. We have dealt with victory and tragedy. We have celebrated and mourned. We lost a few along the way. When our adventure was over, some of us went back home. Some of us started somewhere new, and some of us never came home at all. We have told amazing and hilarious stories of our exploits and adventures. We share an unspoken bond with each other that most people don't experience, and few will understand. We speak highly of our own branch of service and poke fun at the other branches. We know, however, that if needed, we will be there for our brothers and sisters and stand together as one in a heartbeat. Being a veteran is something that had to be earned, and it can never be taken away. It has no monetary value, but at the same time, it is a priceless gift.
Did you write that?
No.
But that's beautiful.
I found that, and I just thought it was perfect, and when you asked me to do this, I thought I have to read that today.
So. Do we know who the author is?
Could no,
we find
I don't.
Out?
Okay. I wish I did,
okay.
Because I would like to give them credit, and it is absolutely right on.
And it was beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing that.
Yeah.
Our first guest here, who is a legend when it comes to Las Vegas. He's very well known in the community for all the work that he's done. He is a Vietnam veteran and has done a lot of work throughout the community for the veterans. And we want to honor that. And we want to thank him for his service and also for being here joining us today on this very special day where we're launching To Our Legacy. And it's all about the families of the Vietnam veterans and how we can support and help them moving forward. And Bruce has been a big part of all of that here in the Las Vegas area and throughout the community. So Bruce, why don't you share with the people a little bit about, you know, the things that you do and whatever you feel comfortable to share is good. I know you and Miriam go back a long ways. And you're here to support her, and we definitely do appreciate that. And again, thank you so much for your service on National Vietnam Veterans Day. And then share your story about this $100 thing. I'm really curious about that. So I am going to turn the mic over to you, and it's all yours.
Thank you so much. First of all, it's an honor and a privilege. I will say, first of all, Miriam and Frank, her wonderful husband for so many years, they are embedded in the center of my heart. Everything that Miriam is doing, I support 100%. What she's doing for the Vietnam families, it touches my heart. So first, regarding the $100, let me start out by saying this. I support Miriam and all that she's doing for the community. So the first thing I want to do is say I am contributing $100 right now, right this second, to Miriam to support all that she's doing for the Vegas community and the Vegas veterans. That's the first thing I want to say. The second thing I'd like to share is, yes, I am a Vietnam veteran. I was in Vietnam in 1968. I've had many discussions about my Vietnam time with Frank, her wonderful husband. So I will share that I arrived in Vietnam on January 2nd, 1968. The Tet Offensive was just exploding right when I arrived on January 2nd in 1968. And I have one story that I'd like to share with everybody because I think it's important for everybody to try to understand what all of us Vietnam vets have gone through. It was April in 1968. We were on a very big patrol in the center of Vietnam. I was in an Army MP Jeep, and it's hard to think back, but I was behind a machine gun. I was behind a machine gun, and my colleague was seated in the Jeep, and the MP driver was in the front of the Army Jeep. It was such a beautiful area in Vietnam. It was a desolate area, but it was gorgeous. I asked the MP driver to please stop the Army Jeep so we could get out and take a picture because the surroundings were so gorgeous. So we got out of the car. I got out from the machine gun and we got a beautiful picture, me and my wonderful friend. When we got back into the Jeep, my friend said to me, "Bruce, you've been behind the machine gun for a long time. I think it's my turn to get behind the machine gun." So I said to him, "Okay." So I was then seated in the Army Jeep. He was behind the machine gun. I asked the MP driver to start the Jeep. He started the Jeep. 5 minutes later, there was a VC sniper attack, and my very best friend was mortally wounded, and he died in my arms. It was the saddest day of my life. It's something that I will never forget. As a result of that, I have suffered from PTSD ever since that incident. But I made a promise to myself in Vietnam in 1968. I had two ways that I could go as a Vietnam veteran. I could play poor little me and say, why me? And why am I still living? And my dear friend died. But I decided that day to take the saddest incident in my life and make it a positive, and that I wanted to impact the lives of people for the rest of my life. And that's what I've chosen to do. So now fast forward with all the wonderful things that Miriam is doing for the Vietnam community. I love not only the Vietnam veterans, but I love all the veterans worldwide. When I'm in an airport and I see somebody in the military, I go up to them and I thank them for their service. But what Miriam is doing for the community and the families of Vietnam vets and veterans, I just applaud Miriam because she has a heart of gold. And I hope that everybody will join me with the $100 that I'm donating to Miriam, and it's well-deserved, and I hope that a lot of other people join me. Because I am part of the VA, I go to the VA all the time, the VA facility in North Las Vegas, and all my doctors are VA doctors. So I see the Vietnam veterans all the time throughout the year, and I'm very aware of all the problems that all the veterans deal with. Some of them have drug problems. Some of them have alcohol problems. Some of them have PTSD problems. But I support all the veterans, and that's why I think it's so beautiful what Miriam is doing. And I know that she also cares very much about the terrible things that have happened with Agent Orange. And when I was in Vietnam, it was a very, very big problem. And the book that Miriam has written, I applaud her. She's a gifted writer, and I also recommend it. There are people that are watching that have not gotten Miriam's book. I hope that they'll consider purchasing her book. So what I want everybody to know, yes, I'm a Vietnam vet. I have been through a lot. And I know what it's like to be in a hostile area under really dangerous gunfire and ammunition. So being a veteran, that's why I say I really salute Miriam, because she's devoting her life to helping veterans' families. And again, I was so blessed to get to know her husband, Frank, very well. And Frank, of course, was in Vietnam as well. So that's why I think what Miriam is doing is so, so important, because the veterans can really benefit from what Miriam is doing, the families of the veterans. I know what it's like because I've been through it myself. And I had so many wonderful talks with Frank, her husband, and we both reminisced on what it's like to be in a hostile environment and have your life on the line every single day. So the fact that Miriam has chosen to have her radar out to help families and veterans, I can't think of a more beautiful thing that Miriam is doing. So again, I'm happy to give my $100 to Miriam, and I hope everybody that's watching will donate money as well, because it is such an important cause, and veteran families, they really can use our support. And from my heart to Miriam's, God bless you, Miriam, for all that you're doing. But again, you have my support. And yes, I'm very blessed. I have a very big, successful entertainment company worldwide, and that's wonderful. But I never for one day forget all the veterans and all the military around the world. So my salute to Miriam and all that she's doing for the veterans and the family. So please join me and join Miriam. Please, $100, if you can give more. If it's less, that's fine too, but let's raise money for the wonderful families and of the veterans. I just cannot tell you how much I am impressed with what Miriam is doing. She has a heart of gold, and I love you, Miriam, and I support all your efforts. Thank you so much.
I want to say it was an honor having you here today and coming from your heart. And that's what this is all about. It's heart to heart, and just really being there supporting humanity. Yes. It's not just about the veterans. It's just about humanity, and it's about people sharing and loving and caring for one another. And, I was very touched by your story, and, I can't even imagine what you went through over there. I had three brothers that were in the Vietnam era at the same time. And, mm-hmm. So I come from a long background, as well, and have high respect, not only for the veterans in this country, but, there were a lot of people involved in that war over there and a lot of victims, and Vietnam itself was a victim.
It was a shame. I mean, again, I could go on for days about all the terrible things that went on in Vietnam. But as you know, I wanted to concentrate on Miriam. But yes, I mean, again, because I'm in the VA, I see the Vietnam vets, Afghan vets, Iran, on and on and on. And I know the torture that a lot of these people are going through. So yeah,
right.
What Miriam is doing is so important. It's very valuable.
It really is. It really is. And when it comes to the toxic exposures and the things that's been damaging to the families because of Agent Orange, that's what this is all about, right? Is to get the knowledge out there about it, to get education out there about it, and actually get resources where people can understand, oh my gosh, that's what's going on. We had no clue, and medical doesn't always help us, understand that, because they're still discovering things. So this awareness that is part of to our legacy, and thank you, for your donation as well, Bruce, because it takes a lot to run this show. It takes a lot to get this research done and to help these families sometimes who have lost everything.
Yeah, so that's why I did want to mention her book and the Agent Orange as well, just so, that's why I did get that in there. And believe me, I have met many people that have been affected very, very badly by Agent Orange. Yeah,
exactly. And we do appreciate everything that you've done, everything that you continue to do.
Sure.
And thank you again so much for joining us here today. And we are going to move on to our next speaker. Hey, welcome back, everybody. We have another amazing guest with an absolutely stunning story. As you all know, this is all a part of the To Our Legacy, a project that Miriam Martinez is putting together to honor not only the Vietnam veterans, but to also make awareness and resources and stuff available for the families of the veterans. And today we have the honor of Alan Lewis being with us. He is a Blue Water veteran. He's going to share a little bit about his story and how he ended up in the Navy and in Vietnam and what he actually did on the ship. So, Alan, welcome to the show. Share your story.
Hello. I decided to go in the Marine or the Navy. Once I graduated from high school, I was 20 years old. My father and my brother and my uncle were in the Navy, and I wanted to do the same for a family tradition. I got stationed in Long Beach, California on a carrier named the USS Kearsarge, CVS 33. And there we deployed on a Westpac cruise, March of 69. And we got back. It was called a little bit short because of decommission, but we got back in September of 69. We went to five or six ports, ranging from Pearl Harbor to the Philippines, Subic Bay in the Philippines. We went to Hong Kong, Japan, and we went to Subic Bay. We also went to Vietnam. We were in the South China Sea, where we had a few mishaps. But all in all, we got back. It was a wonderful trip. And I couldn't have it any other way. It was just perfect. I had V1. I worked in the flight deck division, which was on the top of an aircraft carrier. If you see in movies, you get to see where the planes land and take off. I was part of all of that. So it was an exciting time of my life. So had fun. Thank you.
Well, thanks for sharing that. Now we're going to fast forward into today's world, and we want to hear a little bit about what you're doing, you know, to really support veterans, veterans' families, and, you know, probably other people as well, because you have become an avid platelet donor. Can you share exactly what that is?
Well, some years ago, late the 40s, but I asked my doctor what kind of blood I had. He said red. I said, "Doc, you're a genius." I said, "I would need to know the type." And he told me, "Go to the blood bank." And I went to the blood bank in February of 1999. They told me I was O positive, which is the rare, it's second rarest blood. They kept calling, and I kept showing up. And 2.5 decades later, I've given 1,081 platelets, which equivalents each platelet. A platelet is actually a clotting agent that people need for an open body surgery. And I've helped 1,081 people either survive or help them along in their recovery for life. It's an exciting thing to do. I urge everybody to go and donate blood or platelets. It's a rare group, and I'm just glad to be part of it. And I went last Sunday, and I just passed a milestone of 135 1/4 gallons of product out of my little blood machine, as I call it. So I'm having a blast saving lives. And the service people, I donated my very first time, actually on the flight deck of a carrier. They came out there, but I did whole blood. So the difference between whole blood and platelets, whole blood is used for people if they're having an open body surgery and they don't need a clotting agent. But the platelets are a little bit more valuable than the whole blood. They're both valuable along with plasma. But the platelets are the most needed because they only last 5 days. And that's the shelf life of a platelet. If it's not used in 5 days, it's gone. But normally, O positive. I go, as they say, all around the country. They send me, or they send my platelets, not me, but I wish I could travel as much as my platelets do, but I can't. But they go everywhere to save lives. I've been in almost, I think it's over 30 states, and the furthest donation I gave was in the, it went to a little 8-year-old kid in Guam in the South Pacific. One unit left my body in California, in Southern California, and ended up in Guam 3 days later. Helped save an 8-year-old kid with cancer. We're called the Cancer Kickers in the club, and we just love to donate. There's 16,000 members, which isn't much, but we do the best we can, and donating blood is just, it's in my blood to give blood, so I'll do it till they kick me out, and I've done it 24 years now, and I've got it, hopefully I'll have another 24 to go, but that would be pushing me up against the 100-year mark, and I don't know about that, but we'll see. But thank God we have people like, you know, me and the club and other people that just donate their time and their product to people that need. There's always people that need blood, platelets or plasma. So kick in and give in. That's all you can do. Thank God we're here.
Oh, well, that's for sure. And thank you so much for sharing that story, you know, because a lot of people don't really understand there is more to blood donating than just, you know, drawing the blood and incorporating it and using it for different aspects of life-saving. And that's got to be rewarding. Can you kind of capitalize that on a little bit on how it makes you feel to know that that little red stuff coming out of your body is responsible for saving the lives of so many and the lives of the families of the people that you saved and how they were impacted? Because I'm sure, you know, you don't, maybe I'm correct, wrong here, so correct me. You know, do you ever get to meet someone's life that you saved? And how does that all make you feel?
Well, the thing of it is because of the HIPAA laws, or from what I understand, you can never know who you help. You can know where your product went to, whether it went to Beverly Hills Memorial Hospital, or it went to Tucson International, or whether it went to Texas A&M. You never know who it went to, but they let you know by email. Especially now in this day and age, but they let you know who it went to or to where it went, but not to whom. I hope that was clear. But I donate because I have the O positive, which is the rare blood. I fit 83% of the world. Everybody needs platelets, especially if you do an open body surgery and you have a problem clotting. That's the reason I do platelets, is it's a clotting agent that they need. And I was just blessed with great, great genes as far as being able to produce. I produce 24 donations per year, which is the max you can do. And I've done it over the several years. I've done 22 to 24 donations per year for 20 years or more. It's just, I can't see me doing any other thing other than helping mainly stage cancer kids and leukemia kids because their parents don't have the right blood to help them. And then that's where the platelet donor steps in, which is me and several other thousand people. That I wish the club was more, but it's basically only less than 3% of the people in the United States actually donate blood or platelets or plasma. And I like being in the 3% club. It's fun.
Oh yeah, that's interesting. I didn't know that about platelets. So, what is the difference between a healthy platelet and an unhealthy platelet?
Well, I don't know if there's an unhealthy. If it's unhealthy, they don't take it. First off, it's got to. they put you through a criteria where you have to be tested weekly or biweekly, and they do 4 test tubes. They draw a conclusion whether it's a good product or not. If it's not, of course, they just give it away to science or, you know, classrooms that could use it for demonstrations, but they can't use it on humans. Or if the platelets are good, then your platelet count is like above 300,000, and I run between 305 and 325 most of the time. I've dropped below 300,000, but not rare, or not, it's rare. But everybody that has a problem where if you cut and you can't heal yourself, like a hemophiliac, that's where clotting agents come in, and that's why we're so needed, because some people can't heal themselves, especially the elderly. And then the kids, they can't rely on their parents. You have to have the right blood. You have to have the right type. You have to be OP to OP. You can't mix it up. OP blood is OP blood, but then there's AB negative and AB positive, and there's a few others, but you have to match it up. So that's why when they know that I'm in the chair, they know that they're going to get 3 units out of me. And by the time I usually get out of the chair, which is a couple hours later on the same day, they've already got a place where I'm landing. So I just go, my platelets get in a van, and they go up to Pomona, California, and then they get dispersed nationwide or worldwide, wherever it has to go. It's on a plane the next day. It doesn't waste any time. I donate on Sunday. Most of the time, it's Sunday morning at 7, and by Monday morning, I'm headed somewhere to save a life or to help save a life, and there's no better feeling.
Oh, I can imagine. That's totally awesome. Alan, on behalf of the audience listening here and myself, I want to say thank you and kudos for doing this, because it is of great service. And we're all human, and working together, people to people, to save humanity and live in peace and live in love and work together and save lives and make lives that are more beneficial. Well, no, that's not the right word. Beneficial is not the right word. More a, let's say, maybe a easier life, you know, when they're struggling because of issues with the blood, but to be able to change those lives and the lives, not only the lives of the person that took your blood platelets, but the families that didn't lose their loved one because you gave. And that's what it's all about. It's about giving, and giving because it's a choice and it's the right thing. So, Alan, again, thank you so much for your service for this country and your continued service for saving lives.
I'll add one more. I did what they call an HLA match, and I did go to 2 specific people. There was a lady at UC Davis Sacramento campus. She got all 3 units because she was due to open body cancer surgery. And I ended up going from San Diego, California to Pomona, California to Baltimore, Maryland, to save a 57-year-old cancer patient, a male. I still don't know his name, but they did let me know he was a 57-year-old cancer patient doing an open body surgery. They also took all 3 units to that facility. So I'm blessed to be able to have 2 of them. I wish I could do an HLA match more, but that's rare because it's another group higher than the average platelet donor, which I'm the average platelet donor, but when you can be an HLA match, then you did directly save 2 lives. I've indirectly saved over 1,000 lives now, but directly, I've got 2 lives that depended on my on my product, and it fit them 8-8 for a perfect match. And that's rare. That's even rarer than what I do for normal.
Well, there you go, then. That's a perfect way to end this little story and message that you just shared. Alan, thank you very much. And we are going to move on to our next guest.
546. Keith Kramer is a local actor here in the Las Vegas area. He is doing the honor of reading Frank Martinez's story on Agent Orange.
Agent Orange, Broken DNA, The Enemy Within, written by Miriam Martinez. Agent Orange, the invisible enemy. The journey begins with Frank Martinez, combat soldier and point man, stationed with the 2nd and 16th Rangers in the Republic of Vietnam's Iron Triangles in 1969. His extensive military training and combat experience did not prepare him for the enemies that lurked within his mind and body. Coming home did not remove the nightmares gleaned from the hellhole of combat. Shunned by his fellow Americans and protesters, many veterans felt isolated, abandoned, judged, and damned for fighting for freedom and serving their country. They were exposed to far more than emotional turmoil. Our military was exposed to the unforeseen enemy of chemical warfare known as Agent Orange. The family shares some of their most challenging moments, trials, tribulations, and triumphs as they discover the havoc Agent Orange has caused within their three generations. This book is written from a place of love, healing, and understanding. The sole purpose is to spread education and to awareness to individuals potentially affected and to know you are not alone. Together, we can make a difference.
All right, we're back again. I hope you guys are really enjoying this. My gosh, there's so many beautiful morsels of wisdom and knowledge. You know, pay attention. You'll probably want to watch the rerun again because there's so much to absorb. So, Miriam, let's talk a little bit about what your To Our Legacy Project's goals are. Can you share that with the audience?
Well, our goal is to provide awareness, educational, and resources with support. We're looking to come together with our community for support. As most of you know, that it's lonely when you have family members that are ill, and we just want to embrace them and show them love and let our Vietnam veterans know that they are not alone.
Exactly. You know, even, you know, they felt alone while they were there, you know, fighting to keep this country free. Yeah. And then they came home, and all of a sudden it's like, what did we do wrong? And they didn't, right? So there's a lot of tragedy that takes place in the world, but today is a happy day because we are now getting that word and that awareness out so that the families don't have to think, what did I do wrong? Because they didn't do anything wrong. And we want to make sure that they understand that and what we can do to get those resources and information out and the testing and everything to go on. Because without your support and without your help and coming forward, that's when more and more research can get done and more answers can get done, and hopefully we can end this mess and we can reverse the damage that was created, or at least halt it in its place. That's the mission of To Our Legacy, is to change the issue and make it better, right?
Absolutely. Knowledge creates awareness that leads to research, and that's what our project is all about today, is embracing the families and letting them know, let's see what we can do together as a community.
Exactly, exactly. Well, let's go a little bit into some of the objectives, right? So we talked about, you know, finding online resources. It's not always easy, is it?
No. You try to do your own research out there, you're going to get hit with a lot of information. And, you know, the information is good, but it's up to you to figure it out what's going to fit you and your family and your lifestyle. Having family members that all of a sudden become ill, you know, it shifts life in so many directions, and you want the answers now. And that's what we provide, is a platform that's going to bring our community together as for support.
Stop.
I know.
One second.
This is emotional, and it's okay because she lived the story, and she is currently living it, just like many of you out there today. She had to do all the research on her own to get answers. That's why this is so important, that this message gets out so that you don't have to go through what Miriam went through.
Or her family.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what the project, that's the objective of this project, blah, blah, tongue tire here, so that your awareness and a direction to go, questions to ask, you know, because that was one of the biggest problems, right? What questions do I ask?
Yeah.
You know, they're telling me, oh, well, that's just that. It's all in your head. It's all, you know, mm-hmm. all that stuff they like to say when it really isn't the facts of the matter. And that's why we would love to have you share your stories as well, because that's another part of what's going on here. We want you to reach out to us. Share your stories.
Let's get to know each other.
Exactly. This
that's
is a
how
community
we create a
here.
Solution.
Yes. There's power in numbers. And we would love to help you lead the pack, join the forces, because what starts here in Vegas is going to ripple to every state in the nation. It can even go overseas in other countries, because it's not just our Vietnam veterans here in this country. It's all around the world. That's the mission.
It is.
Right? It is. So you reach out.
Yeah.
And if you got stories, and we're going to talk a little bit about that off and on through this, those stories are what's going to lead the way for more stories to come out for people that even had no clue, and it's going to give them an opportunity to think, well, maybe that explains why this happened. Well, maybe that explains what happened over here. Oh my gosh, I remember 30 years ago. You mean that could have been a part of this? That's the awareness.
Yes.
Because it is generational, and they don't know for sure how many. So we want to help get that message out, right?
Absolutely.
So,
thank you.
Yeah.
That was really great.
Yeah. So we want to be in partnership with you. And who knows, there might be a book in your future with your stories.
Oh, welcome back, everyone. We have another amazing guest coming from Las Vegas. Her name is Michelle Mittmeyer. She is a veteran. She's going to share a little bit about her personal life and how her service to the country. And I just want to say, Michelle, thank you so much for the service that you've given to this country to keep us a free nation. And what we're talking about here today with Mary Martinez is we are launching To Our Legacy, which is a program designed to help the families of veterans and their generations to come by getting information and knowledge out there to the family members and that don't really even understand some of the stuff that's going on from the exposure of Agent Orange and the ripple effect that has happened with some of the health issues that they don't even realize. So that's Miriam's mission, is to get that information out there and help get more research done and get resources, you know, to the families so that they know where to go, what questions to ask, and things like that. And Michelle today here is going to talk a little bit about the real estate, because, you know, a lot of our vets are losing their homes and the wives are losing the homes because they didn't know certain things needed to be in place. So she's going to kind of give us some information about that. And we're just going to make this a fun conversation. So Michelle, I want to welcome you to the stage here and just share a little bit with the audience about your veteran background, and then we'll get into the meat and potatoes of.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Beverly. It's a privilege and honor. I appreciate you having me, and I'll get right into it. My name is Michelle Mitt-Miller. I did 6 years in the Navy. I was fortunate enough to be stationed in Scotland and in Sicily, and at Sigonella, Sicily, in Thurso, Scotland. And it was when they first started putting women on a ship, and I went overseas, and it considered as sea duty, so that I never saw a ship. I was married for 20 years, and unfortunately, the Lord took my husband very early. He was 43 years old, and but I was blessed with two children, and I have five grandchildren now. And I've been in Vegas for over 30 years. I've been doing residential real estate now for almost 14 years. And that is enough about me. And let's get started and see how we can help you.
Well, let's put that in gear, right? And see where it can take us. So let's talk a little bit about this real estate. You know, you've been in it for a long time, and real estate around the country is like out of control. And I know here in Vegas, you know, the prices on real estate and the rents, you know, so talk a little bit about that and how that impacts, you know, I mean, it's going to impact everyone, but we want to focus today on how it really impacts the veterans differently than maybe just other people, and how that happens and what you do about it. Just kind of give us a rundown on that. Could you do that for us, Michelle?
Yes, absolutely. I took some notes here. So if you see me looking down, I'm just glancing here at my notes. Our market is different than anybody else's across the country. We have gaming, and just Vegas has always been different. Rent control is a problem. It's never worked across the country. So rent control here should not work. And it's up in the legislation right now. So it is a big concern, because it would not be beneficial to the homeowners that live here, because it would stop the growth of Nevada. Now, if you own a home and you're in the process of possibly losing it or something like that, there's a lot of programs out there. And not only are there programs out there, but the assumable loan has come back. So anybody that can qualify can assume a VA loan, and they don't have to be a veteran to assume it. There are some other guidelines, but as a veteran, you can assume a VA loan. So there are a lot of options out there. I would like to be in there. So many different what ifs. If you would like a one-on-one with me, I would love to sit down and talk with you, and we can talk, and I can bring you any information that might help you get through or help you navigate through what you're going through. I took some other notes here that you might not know, but there is no age limit. They can't discriminate against age. So a VA loan, I personally did a VA loan for 30 years with an 82-year-old gentleman, and his daughter lived there with him, and she would be able to take the house when he passes. So that was a lot of fun, because when he signed the paperwork, he's like, 30 years, I'm 80, and he's looking at the year that it expires, and he's like, I'm not going to be here, you know. So it was really nice. As for VA spouses, you can qualify for a VA loan, and there's some restrictions. If the veteran dies while in service or service-connected disabilities and you don't remarry, you can use the veteran's VA loan. So
I want to ask you a little bit about some of the things that you just shared here. Mm-hmm. You know, the assumable. Does that mean that if a veteran's wife isn't on, or even is on the lease, sometimes they are, sometimes they're not, you know, on the deed, I should say, not the lease, that they have the ability to assume that property? Or the children can assume the property? How does that work?
Well, if the veteran wants to sell the house, somebody can assume the loan. Okay. If the veteran.
Oh, gotcha.
Okay. Okay. Now, what there are some, you can, like, I'm a veteran, and if I wanted to sell my house, I could sell it to a veteran and they could assume my loan because it's a VA loan. But I could also sell it to a non-veteran and they could assume my loan. However, if I do that, I would lose my certificate and eligibility to purchase another home. So there are restrictions. So if you are getting into that realm or want to sell your house and somebody said you can assume it, there's a lot of restrictions that you want to make sure that you understand what actually the paper says from the VA, so we can follow it exactly and not let you lose your benefit.
Oh, now that is something that people really need to understand. You know, so as a family member of a vet, are we eligible? You know, I mean, I come from a long line of, you know, my dad, my grandparents, you know, and been very active in the service-oriented, you know, realm. You know, so as a child of a veteran, are there benefits for us to be able to get VA loans and stuff, or is it just for the spouses?
And from what I read, it was the spouses. That's something I wouldn't want to answer specifically because I would need to do some more research. But what I read, it would stop with the spouse. You know, okay. I do know that you have, what is it? USAA. And as a service member, any sort of whatever part of the tree you can do, you can talk to them and they do everything. They do home loans, they do house, they do car, they do everything. So that could be somewhere you could go and look into joining.
Oh, okay.
As a sibling of a veteran. That's all you have to do is just let them know where their service connection is, and they let you join USAA.
USAA. Everybody, mm-hmm. Write that down. USAA.
Here, just a second. Let me get you that.
Well, we can put that all in the show notes too, because we're going to put all your contact information and everything in the show notes, so that when people need to reach out, so when the show is over, they'll have all that, you know, in the replays and in the show notes and stuff to be able mm-hmm. to reach out to you, you know, for resources. And that's, again, what we're looking to do here is to get that information out, you know, and the information that you've shared so far, you know, because there's a lot of things that I am learning, you know, interviewing, you know, all of the wonderful guests that we've had so far here, you know, during the show. The information is priceless. And this is what we're looking to do. This is Miriam's mission, is to bring a collaboration of people together like yourself to really say, hey, this is my lane of expertise. This is where I can help, or at least put you in the direction of. And that's critical when it comes to, you know, not only vets, but, you know, everyone out there. There's so much. And I know in the real estate industry, I've had a lot of friends that are in real estate, and it's like every time you turn around, something different is happening. And it doesn't matter where in the country you are. It's like, well, it's different here and it's different there. And just when you think you know where you want to buy that place, all of a sudden it's like, wait a minute, I just talked to you a month ago and now you're telling me that this is no longer true and I got to do what? So
that sums it up very well, Beverly. Very, very well.
Oh my gosh. Okay. I was looking at some of your notes here and talking about the VA funding and fees that get waived. Can you go into that? Yeah.
What that is, have you heard of mortgage insurance?
Yes, I have.
That's a VA mortgage insurance, basically.
Is that a good thing or not so good thing?
Well, basically, the funding fee is you basically pay the fee up front. But if you're disabled, you get that waived and don't pay a penny. So it's a wonderful thing, because I'm sure a lot of these people, if they're from the Vietnam War, they have some sort of disability, so they would never pay a funding fee. But what that's for is that's basically for the mortgage insurance, because the VA loan, you put zero down.
Oh, you wow. Know, so you get zero on the insurance, you get zero down. That's starting to sound pretty good, right?
Oh, a VA loan, that's the beauty of it. It's zero down. And that's why, you know, the 82-year-old that bought the house for 30 years put zero money down.
And then it can just move right into his children. And that's amazing to be
able
to.
It's a blessing. Yes.
It is. And people that don't realize that, you know, when their parents are up in that bracket and still have that ability, still have that power, shall we say.
It's a certificate of eligibility. And it's very easily obtained. I should have thought about it. There is a website that you can go directly to get your eligibility. Or when you speak to a lender, they access it very easily too.
Yeah, and that's something we can get to and get it in the show notes, because the show notes will always be there. And so you can make a note of that, and we'll grab that after the show's over. Because that is something that's really beneficial, you know, to understand and know that. And I like it when there's no age limit, so that, you know, you still have that eligibility. Like you said, you had an 82-year-old guy and he's like, whoa, look what I left for my kids, right? This is something that's really beneficial. And again, it's that knowledge and information that we want to get out there, so the families have that opportunity, especially the wives, because I know there's, like you said, a lot of injuries have come out of Vietnam with Agent Orange exposure. And again, knowing that, and that's one of the things Miriam is capitalizing on, is what are those injuries? How do you ask about those? Because a lot of the symptoms and everything that are being given could be related to a whole lot of things. But when you know your background, when you know it was, you know, the service connection that you have with your father or with your grandfather, or, you know, because now we're into two and three generations, and I think even fourth generation, where some ailments are showing up. And how many of the vets came back and with the PTSD and, you know, all of the confusion, everything that's going on and their illnesses, and they left the family because they didn't know what to do, you know, in the separations. So you, as a wife of that vet, and all of a sudden your children are getting sick and you don't know why, or your grandchildren are getting sick and you don't know why, and you don't think about relating it to Agent Orange. And this is the awareness and the book that Miriam wrote on Agent Orange, you know, the broken DNA, and how it's playing a role in these kids' lives. So anyone out there that's listening, if you are a generation, shall we say, from that Vietnam era, whether you know your father or not, to find and search some answers if you are now having issues with kids or grandchildren. So it's just the awareness. And that's what this whole day is all about, because it is National Vietnam Veterans Day, which is awesome, you know, because it's time they got recognized and acknowledged for what it was and what it is. And, you know, they were not treated very well when they come home. And I never understood that. I had three brothers that were in during the wartime. You know, I had four brothers, and every one of them had been in the service, and one was too young for Vietnam, but three of them were there, you know. So when you look at that, there's a lot. I mean, there's millions out there, and it's not just the U.S. vets. It's all the other countries that fought, including Vietnam. There were a lot of innocent lives that are still being impacted in the country itself. And again, we're all one And we need to start coming together as a unit to start working together to repair or at least have a better quality of life if we know what we're fighting. And that is a mainstay of what Miriam's issue is all about, or I shouldn't say issue, mission is all about, so that she can get that awareness and that knowledge, the resources out there, start getting research done and bringing in people like yourself and the other guests that have been on the show, sharing your lane of expertise and how you work directly with the veterans in all parts of the country. And I have
absolutely
to say,
if they want to move or they need to move or they need anything, I have realtor connections all over the country. I'm going to really intercept real quick. This morning I read an article. There's a 79-year-old Vietnam vet who graduated 60 years after leaving school. He never graduated high school, and he graduated high school. So I just thought that that was a pretty, it says Irvin Harshock, 79, a Johnson, Ohio, left high school in 1961 to take a job in the local steel plant, where he worked there a year before he was laid off. The next move, he joined the U.S. Army. So anyway, I just wanted to kind of throw that out. That's a little bit of, you know.
Thank you for sharing that. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. I mean,
and then one more fun thing that I found.
I like fun things.
That during the Vietnam War, there was hardly any females. Out of 58,220 soldiers, there were only 8 women.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, I just got chills. That's like, whoa, are you kidding me?
No, I thought that was a real fun fact.
Wow.
And I would like, just put it out there, I would like to be the source of your source. If you have any needs, like if your air conditioner breaks, if you need a landscaper, just if there's some, your roofer, if you need anything that pertains to anything, if I don't know, I'll see if I can find somebody for you. But this is a very transient city, and you get taken advantage of. And I don't want that to happen to any of you. And being older or being younger, it doesn't really matter. The con artists are good con artists, and they take a lot of money from this state, and I would not want anybody to be a victim. So if you have any questions, please, I will be happy to get you somebody with references. And don't ever, ever, ever give anybody 100% of the job when they come to estimate your house and they come to do it. Do not give them 100%. Typically, give them a quarter and a quarter and a quarter and a quarter, but if necessary, give them half if they need to get supplies. But be very, very cautious. If you want to call me, I will help you, tell you what websites to go to make sure that they're legit. Just, I don't want to panic you, but I don't want you to get taken advantage of either.
Well, that's taking caution. And thank you so much, Michelle, for sharing that, because it is so true. This is such a transient community, and people do come in, they take advantage. And of course, who are they going to go after, you know? And so we want to believe and we want to trust. And so thank you for going that extra mile. And that shows the integrity in which you work.
Thank you.
And coming from the heart. And that's what this mission is all about. And we are so honored to have you as a guest. And thank you so much for sharing all this wonderful morsels of information, because this is going to make a difference in the lives of the vets and their family. And like I said earlier, all of Michelle's information is going to be in the show notes. So reach out to her and let her guide you in the direction that you need to go. So any final words, Michelle?
Just God bless you and know you're never alone.
Well, there you heard it. You're never alone. And Miriam likes to say to all the Vietnam vets, welcome home. And Michelle is the epitome of welcome you all home, because she treats you as an equal. Thank you, Michelle. And now we are going to take a short commercial.
Thank you. Hello, folks. This is Mac Jackson Jr. from Vanderson Cyber Group. The problem with businesses today is that they are affected by cyber attacks from around the world, but companies are not sure of what to do. Normally, they are reactive instead of proactive. But folks, cyber attacks can affect your bottom line, and it will affect you financially, legally, and your business reputation. Here at Vanderson Cyber Group, we can help you develop a policy by training your employees on what to do if they are involved in a cyber attack and how to mitigate it and fight against it. Folks, we call it here hashtag stay cyber woke. And that's Vanderson Cyber Group here in Las Vegas and around the world. You can reach me, folks, at VandersonCyberGroup.com or my website, MacJacksonJrJr.com as well. Here locally, 702-868-0808. Give us a call today, folks. We must fight back.
Tip?
Oh, Deborah Sweeney from Las Vegas. She is our next guest, and she has one of the most beautiful stories to share with all of you lovely people out there. And you know what? She may not be a vet, but she couldn't be any closer to the vets' hearts than when you hear what she has to share and what she is doing with vets from wherever they come. And, you know, I'm honored to be able to know this woman and discover what she has done. And now you're probably saying, well, what is it? Come on, what is it? Well, first off, I want to say thank you to Miriam Martinez and to John Stiles for actually running this show. Yes.
Yes.
And Miriam's mission is to launch to our legacy and welcome home all the Vietnam vets on this day that they've set aside for National Vietnam Veterans Day. And Miriam's mission is to really get the information, knowledge, awareness out to the masses and to allow the families of vets to understand that the exposure to Agent Orange is a real thing, and is it causing an issue with their generations? If you have had a vet in your family that was a Vietnam vet exposed to Agent Orange, you know, in any of the wars, you need to know this. You need to understand it. You need to start reaching out. Pay attention. What is going on with your children's in the generation and generations, right? Her awareness is to get that information out and also to get research done, to get resources available, to know that you do have rights coming from a vet who has served this country. And I want to say kudos again off to every one of you who served, whether it was in the Vietnam War or anywhere, right? And we also are honoring Vietnam themselves, because there's been a lot of victims during that era, and it wasn't all by choice. None of it was by choice. So that is what we're all about here today. And this lovely lady here, Miss Deborah Sweeney, is going to share with you what she is looking for to help the veterans. And it's all about having good food.
It is about having good food. We are creating hydroponic systems that will be in local areas starting in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Very familiar to one of your family members. And our goal is to actually create systems that veterans can own. And the tagline is very simple. Just add water, because we're going to do it from A to Z, from soup to nuts, and actually provide the system. All they have to do is provide the building, and we're gonna buy the fresh produce, the fresh leafy greens, the herbs, everything that the veterans are going to grow, we're going to buy it, and we're going to do the marketing and sales for them. So
how about
we
that?
Want to provide wonderful, wonderful opportunities for veterans to be able to kind of work from home, get in, be able to produce some fresh veggies, and actually help their community and still serve.
You know, that's what I found so unique about this. When you shared that with me, I'm thinking, are you serious? Actually, now think about this. If you're living out in some remote area, I mean, even in the city of Chicago, you don't always get fresh vegetables. They have to get shipped from California,
right.
Mexico.
Right.
You don't know how they were raised. You don't know what was sprayed on them.
No, correct.
You know, just saying, right? You know, so how would you like to be able to go to your local grocery store and get fresh grown vegetables in the city that you live in, just up the street somewhere, helping the veterans and their family? And that's giving them something to do. And you mentioned, you know, the Tulsa area. I grew up on a farm in Iowa a long time ago, you know. And so when she shared that with me, I love growing my own vegetables. I love, you know, growing my own herbs and stuff like that. So, and coming from a family of 11, and we're all have that bug in us, so we're all growing our own gardens regardless of where they are. And so my brother, who also served in Vietnam, is in that same area.
That's so cool.
And, you know, he knows a lot of vets. So
yes. And we have 4 veterans already that have said that they want to be part of it in this area. But we're going to obviously do a research and development model so we can test it. We can test the market. But we're really excited about offering this to veterans because we think it will do a lot of things. You're right. It's going to provide communities with fresh, grown, organic, nutritious, wonderful food, produce, right?
Yeah.
It's going to really help every community that we're able to touch. And instead of, you know, when Henry Ford started, he took all of these automobiles and took it to a central location. We're doing just the opposite. We're actually going out and going to individual communities. And with the help of the veterans in those communities, we're going to be able to provide fresh farm-to-table food.
You know, when you said hydroponics, that's dear to my heart. I mean, we're looking at the ecosystem, and we're looking at, you know, water. Water is probably one of the most precious minerals, precious liquid on the planet. Because you know what? We have to have water to live, and we have to have oxygen to live, right?
We can't live without water, absolutely.
So.
There's a water crisis in this country.
Yes,
too.
There is. A lot of people don't realize that. So when you're saying the hydroponics, I know what you're doing is a little bit more intense than the hydroponic, where it's like all you do is add the water. So they've got this down to an art. This is so cool. Now, you correct me if I'm mistaken here. But what you said was that you know exactly how much water it takes recipe for growth. So imagine that. Every drop of water that goes into this garden to grow these vegetables is utilized by the plant itself, not running off into the waste
absolutely,
or anything like
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely.
I mean, it can't get much better than that.
Not one extra drop. And it's not typical hydroponics. It doesn't sit in the water. We actually mist it. Our name is going to be Blue Mist Microfarms, and we actually mist it so we don't have to use any excess water. And the other thing is, even though these are grown under lights, it's going to be powered by solar.
Oh, well, there we go.
So there
you got it. You know, you got the solar. You've got the building. We didn't even talk about that. The building is going to be out of material that's actually going to be beneficial to be more efficient, you know, as well, right? So now you got efficiency in the building, in using solar with the electricity stuff, and you've got not a waste of water, and you probably don't even use nasty chemicals.
None.
Did you hear that? None. Let's do that again. None. Can you tell we're an advocate of that?
Yes.
You know, because we want healthy bodies.
We do.
Healthy air, healthy life, healthy lifestyle, and
make a difference in humanity.
Make a difference and also be able to create a sustainable income for veterans should they choose to do this.
Right, that's and really something they can pass on through generations,
absolutely,
right?
Absolutely,
absolutely.
Yeah. So,
yeah. You know, and what better assistance can it be, you know, to a veteran to give them a purpose in life that's going to change and leave a legacy?
Yes, absolutely.
And what are we launching?
Legacy.
To our legacy.
Yes.
Right? Because that's what it's all about. You know, we all kind of want to leave our legacy, leave our mark on the world. And don't forget, we are still looking for stories. Everything that we've talked about, all of the wonderful, wonderful guests that have spoken here today, all of their information, their contact information and everything is going to be available in the show notes, thanks to John.
Yay.
Right?
Thank you, John.
So make sure you check out the show notes, share what you've heard. And if you like what you've heard, start, you know, talking here, start liking and giving us some words of wisdom and kudos and all that good stuff, because you know what? That's what keeps us going, right?
Right. And I'm excited to connect with veterans. I really am. My brother was a veteran. He was my first, right? My brother served in Vietnam War. And I gave birth to a couple.
There you
go. And they married a couple.
Well, there you go.
So we just have a whole family that's reproducing.
You know, and that's wonderful. And we want the reproduction to keep on going in a safe, healthy environment.
Yes.
Physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, you know, that's what the whole world is all about, and change humanity, right?
Yes, and thank you so much for this opportunity.
It's been an honor. It's been an honor having you here and sharing what you're doing, because that is what's going to leave an impact on all of humanity.
I really do believe it will, and I do believe eating healthier and healthier will just not only extend our life, but make life joyous while we're living it.
There you go. You just heard it. So thank you again. And this is, we're getting down to the nitty gritty. So we have one more guest following this, and we should be good to go. And I want to thank every one of you who have came and joined us tonight. Go out there. Be safe. Be fun. And eat healthy.
And thank you all for your service. We appreciate it
yes,
so much.
Yes, we do.
Okay.
And that concludes this, and we'll be on to the next guest.
John Stiles here, host of Doing It With Stiles here on WWDB-TV. If you're a CBD oil user and a coffee drinker, I got some great news for you. I found this hemp-infused coffee from Planet Harvest Health. That's planetharvesthealth.com. Now, this happens to be the Swiss chocolate almond, which I'm kind of fond of. I used to take the CBD oil, put a couple drops under my tongue, and I didn't really like the taste of it that great. So I started dropping it in my coffee in the morning. So figured that would kind of kill it. Well, it kind of screws up the taste of the coffee. When I found this, it's awesome. It's great tasting coffee. You brew it just like your regular coffee, and you get all the benefits of the hemp. So check it out on planetharvesthealth.com. They got a lot of other great products. They've got spices, they've got oils, they've got creams. So check them out on planetharvesthealth.com. Thank you. And remember, like Planet Harvest Health, if you're going to do it with Stiles.
All right, welcome back. How'd you like those last speakers? Weren't they, like, awesome?
Wow.
I know, so powerful. And wow, we are so honored that our guests are joining us here today, because they are a part of that awareness and everything else. One thing I would like to touch on that most people don't even think about. There are a lot of victims of wars, not only Vietnam, but all wars. Look at the country of Vietnam itself and everything that transpired over there. I mean, their whole country was about destroyed.
Yeah.
You know, when you look at all the nature, look what it did with nature. But look about the families, the innocent people there. And you know what? They don't even know why we were there. You know, I grew up in that era, so I could probably get on a rant, but I'm not going to go there. You know, so let's not only honor our Vietnam vets over here and their families, let's also reach out and recognize the country that was almost destroyed
by decision. And,
yeah, and now they are working their way back just like we are. We're all one.
Yeah.
Let's bring the world together to make it a better place. Right?
Absolutely.
All right.
That's my heart right there.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, you're so welcome. We're going to talk a little bit about this project because it's not something that's just going to happen today and be done. So I know you're on a timeline.
Yes, I am.
So you've got a lot of little pieces and parts to this.
Yes.
So just like roughly, you know, just give a bullet as to what people can look forward to make this project continue and get bigger and bigger and better and better.
Well, I'm just going to go with the next couple of months here. Right now we're looking for veterans, their spouses, the children for their stories, to start building our community. We're looking for partnerships to take us right in the direction that we need to be for the technology. We're looking for companies to support us, business owners to support us in the community. That's basically our next 6 months right there.
Yeah, it's gonna be a big project.
It's huge, and it's not stopping there.
Exactly.
This is going to be generational.
Exactly.
We're going to get into the technology that's coming up, and you know, it's a win-win.
And technology changes every single day, right? And the research is changing. They have better equipment. They can look deeper into the blood and into the DNA and into the cell structures and all of that. And they can actually break down the toxic ingredients that played a role. So that's kind of what we have to look forward to, but we really do need your support.
And that's called hope.
Hope.
That's called right. Hope for our generations.
Yeah.
You know, I've followed the medical field and the technology out there very closely for many, many years. I'm not an expert by all means in anything except my own knowledge. And the technology and the research that they have for rare diseases, they can literally go into a person's DNA now and clip it and reconstruct it, which, you know, it might be a few more years, but I know our rare diseases nonprofits out there, they are looking at that for cures because this is running rampant.
Right, and Miriam has over 40 years of experience. And that's not a nice word to go through the heartache and the struggles that she went through, her and Frank, with her children and now with her grandchildren. And it continues. And we know that there's a lot of you out there. You're not alone. You're not alone. That's one of the biggest things, the message that we want to get out is no one out here is alone when it comes to this. You know, there's going to be a link for contact information, and you'll, you'll receive a form to get your story out there. And there'll be certain things that we're looking for in those stories. And we are looking to have 30 stories from people just like yourself listening in today to share to the world and get this message out, get this awareness out by June 30th of 2023.
Get busy.
That's right. So we really need you to find that link and share your story and make a difference, not only in the lives of your family members, but those around the world, right?
Yeah.
So, wow.
I think the timeline, you know, I mean, we could go in for months because there's like 18 months I think she has, you know, burnt out here. But right now, we want to just focus on today what needs to happen, right?
Yes, and, absolutely.
You know, we still have a little bit left here in the show. We've got a couple more guests that we are going to share some things with, and then we'll be back.
Looking for a home in Las Vegas? Well, you're in luck. Hi, my name is Joe Waschuk. I'm a realtor with Century 21 Gavish Real Estate here in Las Vegas. And I'm here to let you know that buying a home as a veteran can be easier than you think. Here's what I could do for you. Assist you in finding a VA-approved lender. After you've been approved, I can set you up to find your dream home with an automated search, and I will make your appointments for you. To ensure you have a smooth closing on your home, I will help you from start to finish. Please contact me for a free consultation at 925-334-2419. Let's build your wealth one home at a time. I'm Joe, and I know.
And welcome back.
Welcome, everyone.
Oh, gosh, wasn't this exciting?
Oh, my gosh. Oh, it's been so fun.
It has been, and the stories and the information, and it's just, it's so enlightening, and so... What we want to talk right now is because we got a big surprise. Tour Legacy is moving into technology. And that technology is called virtual reality. Now, you're probably thinking, what is virtual reality? Well, it's the metaverse. And you know what? The metaverse is a huge platform of digital things. It encompasses everything, your computer, your phone, the internet, you know, all those wonderful things. We have a platform called Megaverse. And on that platform is Tour Legacy, which is going to be there for everyone who would like to come bring their families in, because it's with the click of a button.
Yes.
Right? So it's with the click of a button.
You have to share the name and what it means.
The Tour Legacy? You do that.
No, not that.
Oh, Megaverse?
Yes.
Oh.
I love this part.
Megaverse stands for the Great Positive. And that's what we're doing in that platform. It's family, it's friendly, all built on education, and
resources,
and business, and we do entertainment. So there's things in there for kids of all ages and adults of all ages, because you know we're all kids at heart, right?
Yes, absolutely. Every chance I get.
Exactly. And in this virtual reality space, you're an avatar. So you can make yourself look like whatever you want. You can be taller and you can be shorter. You know, you can dress the way you want, but what we're doing, everything is hyper realistic here. So it is really like being there in the real world. And the reason why we're bringing this out and we're so excited about it is because now you can become an avatar. So let's just say, you know, maybe you got a few struggles and you're not able to move and be as vibrant as you once were. When you're in that avatar and you're in the virtual reality space, think about this. Here you are, grandma or grandpa, and it's like, you know, I just don't have the fire under my, you know what, like I did. And now I've got these little grandkids that are 2 and 3 and 5 and 6 and 10, right? And they want to, you know, get all that energy going. As an avatar, you can run up the mountain with them. You can ride a bike. You can fly in some of the planes we have up there. You can go jump in the ocean. There's so many fun things that you can have to share with your families. And so Miriam is creating Tour Legacy in that virtual reality space so families can come together, be able to see the stories, hear the stories, communicate and talk with each other, because, you know, we don't always live next door anymore. You know, what if you have a loved one that's no longer on their own and they're in assisted living?
Or
now
in a
you can be there with
spinal cord hospital.
Spinal cord hospital, exactly.
I've experienced that, and unfortunately, our spinal cord hospitals with the VA, they have the technology, but sometimes they can't get the families there. And that was sad. It was really sad for me to see that. And this will solve that problem.
It does. It does, because you can put it on a laptop.
Yeah.
You can put it on a tablet.
And in the spinal cord hospital, you know, they set up their patients with everything they need. And if they're not able to move, they have technology that will help them.
That's
with a blink of an eye, a blow inside of a straw, whatever the case may be. But this is going to solve
a huge
problem.
Yeah, yeah. It's just going to bring these families. No, it's going to bring everybody together.
Yeah.
You know, so that's the nice thing about it.
Yeah.
And it's just click and you're there. We are in that age of digital. We are in the computer age, right?
Yeah, we are.
And so it doesn't matter what age that is, because there's someone there that's going to be able to run that screen to where now you are immersed in it. Because you're side by side, just like we're here, side by side.
And we are not avatars. You can be like this.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and again, anyone can go in there any hour of the day, any country, any time zone, and be a part of that community and bring it to life and really be able to chat with fellow countrymen and service people.
Family members.
Exactly. So
another great thing about this is that we're looking at creating a legacy for the families that have been affected by the DNA disruption. You know, medical challenges occur all the time. I know it does in my family. And sometimes, you know, being financially stable is the hardest thing in those situations, where families need an extra income coming in. So this platform can solve that problem as well. So I'm just happy and blessed to see all this stuff coming together. And I just...
And that's where the resource directory, you know, so that information is there for people to find. And it's like, oh my gosh, what note did I put it on? Where did it go? I can't find this. And you don't know what the names are. Because sometimes when you're in the midst of that trauma, your thinking isn't where it needs to be. But
that
when
you
can come to a source like that,
click, absolutely.
And you're there.
Secure source. You pop in everything you need for you, the uniquely you. Is going to be right there.
Exactly.
What you are looking for, what you need in this. What research do you need? What assistance do you need? How can we support you?
Yeah, and it is a community in there. So the community is going to support the community. And there'll probably be like a questionnaire board or something where people can put something up. I need help with this, if anybody can help. And then they can send those answers back. So that's the community bringing that all together.
Oh,
that's
absolutely
powerful.
Yeah.
And to be able to do that on a platform that is just clicking, you're there.
Yes.
So we're excited about the virtual reality space and how it can definitely impact the world.
In a good way.
In a great way.
Awesome. I love it.
Well, you know what? We got one more commercial break and then the show's over. So stay tuned. We'll be right back. Wow, the evening's over. Can you believe it? It's been an honor being here today, and I want to thank everyone who has joined us, whether you're in the listening part after the fact or if you were here with us today. And again, it's been an honor. Thank you, Miriam, for sharing this beautiful story. Thank you, Frank, and thank you, all Vietnam veterans, on this your day to actually be acknowledged, recognized, and honored. All I can say is thank you for serving this beautiful country. And thank you the world over.